blog post on how to do mining on called blockoperations.com. And I was mining Ethereum and Zcash and then Zclassic, and got together with a few of the folks in the Zclassic community, which is a great community, and to talk about how to try to do some things and make some changes. People like, well, we're not really going to do that. So I talked with a few folks, and I owned some Dash masternodes at the time, so I liked what Dash had done with their governance and paying their node operators and having a fund to fund development. And so we talked about, well, why don't we do a version of Zcash that does, like, having a fund for paying developers and also paying people to operate nodes. And one of the other guys we were talking with said, well, let's do it as a chain split off Zclassic. And I didn't know what a chain split was. Everybody kind of knows what that is now, because there's Bitcoin, and then Bitcoin Cash was a chain split off Bitcoin. And so everybody who owned Bitcoin then owns Bitcoin Cash. We did the same thing with Zclassic. So when we launched a little over a year ago, I guess back in May of 2017, everybody who owned Zclassic all of a sudden owned Zen Cash. And that was great. We went up to Consensus in New York City. We were announcing the launch there. We had a party. We met some good folks there. Thank goodness we met some good folks. And because it turned out that a week after we launched Zen Cash, we found out, as our lead developer quit and started attacking us and hacking things, that he had coded in a vulnerability to have the chain split protection go away. So when you do a chain split, you got to have something called transaction replay protection, because everybody, the two, you can, basically what happens is people would withdraw their Zclassic from an exchange, and then they could take that same transaction and replay it onto their Zen Cash or the other way. So we were getting transaction replays happening. BitTrex shut our wallet down. It was down for weeks. I was on the phone a couple times with the owner of BitTrex. Cool guys, a bunch of former Microsoft security guys that went out and started BitTrex. They really know what they're doing. So they're a good exchange. They helped us through. And then one of our advisors, who we met at Consensus and then talked to before, my partner, Rob Biglioni, who helped start Zencash, also knows a lot of people in the cryptocurrency community. And so one of our advisors was Charles Hoskinson, who was the CEO of Ethereum and heads up IOHK. And if you know, if you've heard of Cardano, you know Charles Hoskinson. So we're on the phone with him. He's like, hey, I got this development team in Ukraine, and I'll put them at your disposal and we'll fix the problems. I'm like, that's great. So we got one IOHK development team. We couldn't be public about it, but they fixed the transaction replay problems. And he's like, we'll leave them to take care of anything else you want. Well, one of the first things we wanted to do was to have encrypted transport all the way through. Just like, you know, when you go to a website and you have a lock on the browser, a little green lock. Bitcoin and most other cryptocurrencies, they don't encrypt the transport. So that was like the first basic thing. Because we want to be really secure, really usable, and up and running all the time. And so they did that for us, and then we're able to at least, you know, get our wallet open and get things running. And then we put in place a plan, and because we had funding to hire developers, we were able to, over time, build a team. So anyway, that was the genesis of smart contracts start to get threatened. The people whose current business models are being disrupted might not like it. So I put this quote up from Gandhi about, you know, first being ignored, and then they laugh at you, and been laughing at Bitcoin for a while, but I don't think folks are laughing at Bitcoin as much. And now there's attacks in all sorts of different directions, whether it's doing being able to short Bitcoin and doing an artificial bubble in December and then have going into a long bear market, or ridiculing it, or tracking people down who are using Bitcoin and accusing them of being money transmitters without a license, throwing them in jail. There's just a lot of different attacks that are happening. So one of the things that we figured out early on at Zen Cash is, okay, we're going to be attacked at some point, especially if we're all about privacy. Because Zencash has a feature of being a fork from Zcash of having the ability to have completely private or anonymous transactions, untrackable. If you do something on Bitcoin, your address, which is a pseudo-anonymous address, is there on the blockchain and anybody can view it anytime. 10 years, 20 years from now, people are going to be able to go see what that address does. And sometime in the next two decades, if they're able to tie that address to you through an email or something like that, they can figure out what your entire Bitcoin transaction history is. So that's an issue. That's one of the reasons why Bitcoin is mostly used for legitimate type transactions, because people know that they're going to get tracked by using it. So as a cryptocurrency miner, I'll buy a bunch of miners from Bitmain in China, and I'll send them, you know, however much Bitcoin, and boom, they'll ship it over. And that's great. That's a fully legitimate transaction. There's a lot of other types of transactions or things that you might want in your life that you might want to have privacy for. Everybody wants privacy in their life. And, at some point, I mean, like, I've got windows on my house, but sometimes there's things that I like to do in my house that I don't want people seeing, so I pull the shades down. Being able to have selective privacy or the ability to consent to the disclosure of information is important. I'll give you another example. If you run a business or you're part of a business, do you want all your employees to be able to figure out what every other employee is getting paid? If you pay them in Bitcoin, they might be able to figure that out. You might want to be able to have private transactions so nobody can see what everybody else is getting paid. You also might not want your competitors seeing who you're buying from, who you're selling to. So if you're going to be using Bitcoin or a cryptocurrency that doesn't have privacy inherent, some of the things that you might take for granted about privacy, like in business, things like that, don't exist. So that's why privacy-focused cryptocurrencies, I think, are going to become more and more important. That's one of the reasons why we wanted to take the Zcash privacy technology and have a different version of that, Zencash. We just announced today on our live stream that we're going to go through a whole branding change, so there's not a bunch of confusion about it. And make it very usable. So usable wallets, internationalization for people all over the world to be able to use it, and making sure it's up, running, and reliable and can't be attacked. So that was what we laid out in our white paper, and that's what we've been building towards this whole year. And now we have a great team of developers, and we're going on to advance the second stage. So what I got up here is, most people don't know that in Zcash or other zero-knowledge proof cryptocurrencies like Zencash or the other ones, the standard transactions with an exchanger for mining are all regular Bitcoin type transactions. They're all transparent. You can see them on the blockchain and track them. When you go to a shielded transaction, that's when the privacy is inherent. Now the nice thing about Zencash is you have the two different types of addresses, transparent and shielded addresses. And you can send one from another. So I can go to Bittrex, for example, or Binance, and buy some Zencash, and I can withdraw it to my CoinOmi wallet on my phone, or my full node wallet running on my Mac or PC or Linux, and then I can send it to a shielded address. Once it goes to a shielded address, that's shielding it. You can look on a blockchain explorer, and all you'll see is that there was a transaction from an address with a certain amount to a shielded address, and you don't see what the shielded address is. Then I do shielded to shielded transaction. It shows up on the blockchain just as a transaction happened. No sender, no receiver, no amount. And then when I send from shielded to transparent, it's, you don't know who it's from, but you see an amount and a receiving. So you can actually self-shield your own cryptocurrency. One of the things that we announced just last month is a partnership with Pornhub. We want to have usability and use cases. So porn is one of those things that is legal, but it's morally questionable in some cases, so people might want to have privacy around it. And so now people have the option, instead of using a credit card, they can go on and sign up for a subscription. The most common reaction I get is, why would people pay? But that's all there. But you know, you think about, okay, what are some of the things that are legal, but you might not want people to know that you're doing? And that's our initial market for privacy cryptocurrencies. You know, and whether it's around the sex industry or drugs, you know, illegal drugs, whatever. But legal drugs like cannabis.
Illegal somewhere drugs.
Illegal somewhere, that's what I mean. It's not like we're promoting the whole underground economy. Exactly. But that's why you go to California, right? No, so, and heck, I'm talking with one guy that's on our team in South Carolina. I'm like, just go to gun shows and rent a table, because people are just using cash left and right. You can buy guns at a gun show in cash, but nobody's going to use a credit card because they don't really want those types of transactions. So that's our initial market. People, the use cases for privacy. But as the technology expands and gets easier, I think people are going to want privacy in all their transactions. And so the technology behind this is a zero-knowledge proof, where you can prove that you did something, but you don't have to expose it. Which there's some really advanced cryptographers that developed this, and I'm going to just kind of leave it at that. But right now, it's kind of difficult to do the fully secure or private or anonymous transactions. You have to actually download a wallet that can do those, and you can do that on a PC or Mac or Linux. Little lightweight wallets, you can't do that yet, but it's coming. As with every technology, there's a minimum viable product. You get it out there, you see what the interest is. One of the things that we enabled in our wallet is messaging. So this shielded transaction, it contains a memo field, a 512 character memo field, kind of like the memo field on a check when you send it to somebody. So we actually enabled messaging threads. So if you have a wallet or a client that can reach the Zencash blockchain, you can send a minimum fee transaction to somebody, and you can send a message. Fully encrypted, nobody can see where it came from, where it came to. It takes a little while to get there, but I'll give you a use case. Say you're in a country that has an oppressive government, and you're a reporter, and you want to get tips from people, information, or payment. You publish a website, put a Zencash shielded address on there, and say, hey, send me information. Send me funds if you like what I do. So you can go to your wallet, and you could send to their shielded address, and they would have no idea who it's coming from, wouldn't be able to figure out who it's coming from. You could send them short messages. Yeah, heck, you could publish something anonymously and send a link to it. Yeah.
Somebody's giving an example, another speech on illegal contraband using the idea of selling Bibles in North Korea. And could somebody in that country now access, have full access to this and use the same concealment and
so
forth?
So probably. So if they can access the internet, now, and that's why.
And they have electricity.
But if they can access the internet, now there are, but there are country level firewalls that can be locked down to prevent types of things. And so people implement VPNs, or their domain fronting was a thing until all the people shut that down.
So it's doable but difficult.
Well, if we can get a node in there, and that's the other thing, if we can get a node that a wallet can connect to, then it's doable. Uh-huh. And so to address that, we said, we're going to pay people to run nodes, which is, you know, kind of a crazy idea. But what was this? Oh, treasury and governance. So let me go to the secure nodes. I'll get back to the treasury and governance. So we pay people to run nodes, and nodes is what the wallets connect to. So when new Zencash is mined, instead of 100% going to the miners, only 70% as of next week is going to the miners. 10% is going to the community funds, which are nonprofit, then turns around and spends on marketing and development and making things better. 10% goes to people that are running nodes. So right now we have 13,000 people all around the world running nodes, and every week we pay them. So we take the 10% of the blockchain reward. I think there's 216,000 new Zen per month. So 10% of that gets distributed. So I don't know, what's that, 1.5 Zen per month? Every person running a node? And the node, you gotta have a TLS certificate, gotta keep it up and running, gotta have the full blockchain, and you have to, when challenged, create a shielded transaction. So we create a base layer of shielded transactions throughout the world for some noise. And you gotta show that you care about Zen. So you gotta have 42 Zen to run the net.
42.
That's the ultimate answer.
That's the answer.
That's why I came up with that. Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, you know.
are there services that you can outsource the running of the nodes?
There are. There are people that run, Now they're a little more, like just like masternode services, but they're a little more difficult on the processors. So. There are people that are essentially running old Dell servers and running Linux containers and running a bunch of nodes and hosting other people's nodes for them. So you have to buy it and then contact it. So all you need to do is really keep the Zen in an address, and that's the address that it gets paid to. So you don't hand over the 43 Zen to the people running the nodes. But it requires a 64-bit operating system, about 4 gigs of memory. Will be about 2 gigs of memory here in our upgrade next week. And then we came up with a new class of nodes called super nodes, because in order to implement the two main improvements that we're looking to do, we have to create, develop, and run sidechains. So our relationship with IOHK continues. We have been doing two research projects for us. One of them's already been delivered. So we wanted a treasury and voting process that was provably reliable, had secret ballot using zero-knowledge proofs, and could be used to help guide the direction of Zencash in the future. So some academics and developers at IOHK developed that. They created it on something called ScoreX, which is a way to create blockchain, and they program it in Scala, which is a, I'm not a software developer. So anyway, it's good stuff. And on our blog, we have one of the developers given a presentation on it, and also there's the download of the 35-page white paper, which has a lot of mathematics that I don't understand.
So you're just keeping track of node uptime and all that kind of stuff?
Yeah, so it's going to be a separate blockchain that's going to run on the supernode. Okay. We call them supernodes just because they have a higher processing.
And this is a 42 Zen.
No, the secure nodes are 42. Super
okay,
nodes,
so yeah. you haven't talked about super nodes. Am I jumping?
I haven't talked about super nodes yet.
Okay, sorry.
That's okay, no. Because super nodes are sidechains.
Perfect.
It's a great lead-in, right? You need 500 Zen for each of those. So you really care. we got a white paper on the design for it. We're going through the development on it right now. But basically, we bootstrapped our cryptocurrency from a year ago when we had an idea and a chain split to now we've got a good-sized team. We have good developers. We also have good agreements with IOHK and then a Ukrainian development team called InfoPulse. So we're going through and implementing this. Software development, it takes time. So we have a good-sized community and people always have to know it. So we got multiple development teams, parallel development. We got decent wallets right now, lightweight and full size for your computer. If any of y'all want $5 worth of Zen, put a Zencash wallet on your phone and I'll pay you tonight. If you have an iPhone, install a Coinomi wallet. As you install a Coinomi wallet, you'll probably need to write down a password and a 12-word phrase. If you have an Android, we have a Zen native wallet, which is even easier to use, or the Coinomi wallet. And these are transparent transactions, so at some point in the future, they might be able to be tracked. We follow the Zcash development, and I was fortunate to be able to go to the Zcash conference a couple weeks ago in Montreal, where we heard from their cryptographers and developers. We've got a new version of the ZK Snarks, the Zero Knowledge Proofs, coming up. And their sapling upgrade, which will give us the ability to develop and have full shielded transactions and addresses on a mobile phone sometime in the future. So, yes, as well as hardware wallets. Yeah.
What's the possibility of in the future with any of the sort of Zcash family exchanges actually doing to show the transactions to Z wallets out of the exchange? Have you guys talked to any exchanges about doing that?
We haven't talked to any, but there's one place where you can actually do a shielded transaction to and get services. Mm-hmm. It's from the company Private Internet Access, the VPN providers.
Okay.
The other nice thing about the sapling upgrade and the redoing of the ZK Snarks is that to do a shielded transaction right now on a decent laptop like that one, it takes probably 30 seconds and 4 gigs of memory just to create one. To read it, it's a lot easier. And after that upgrade, it'll take 5 seconds and almost no memory.
So maybe it can be easier for exchanges in the future?
Exactly. So right now it's processing prohibitive for most exchanges to be able to do shielded transactions. The other thing we don't have is display keys or selective transaction. I'm showing people that if I sent you a shielded transaction right now, you could say, nope, didn't get it.
Right.
And I'd be like, well, and I have no way to prove that I actually sent it to you. But if I had selective transaction disclosure,
right,
which is again coming in the sapling version, then I could say, okay, well, here's a view key. Look, I actually did send it to you. So you got to have these. Once you get into shielded and private transactions, you have to get into shielded display. All right, yes.
Okay, can I have more than one question, but I'm just going to ask them real quick. Because I got my turn in. So the Zcash, when it was created, they had this big, you know, ritualistic ceremony where they created like keys or whatever. Are you guys somehow connected to that initial creation because you're a split of the split of the split? And if something went wrong with that, would Zcash be exposed? And the second question is, are you guys doing proof of work? And why did you select this or that algorithm or whatever? And the third question is, what's to prevent the Zcash foundation from using the 10% reward on the person below?
Awesome. Great series of questions. All right, so we follow Zcash upstream development. We actually do. No.
7%. That's all.
We got a lot of Vegas a lot.
Okay, right.
Okay, so we follow Zcash upstream quite a bit. So ZK Snarks is one version of doing zero knowledge proof. The advantage is they're fast and they're very small on the blockchain, so they minimize blockchain bloat. The disadvantage is that they have to have a trusted setup, which is what you're referring to.
Yeah.
And so Zcash did a trusted setup where six people came into the trusted setup, and if any one of them threw away all their information, the toxic waste, the trusted setup would be good. If all of them kept it and then colluded, they would be able to secretly create Zcash out of thin air, and you wouldn't know it. In fact, that was one of the discussions at the Zcash conference. They're like, what if somebody figured out a way to break that, because this is all still fairly experimental, and we start seeing more Zcash come out of the shielded transaction realm than was ever created. What do we do at that point?
Mm-hmm.
And they're a bunch of really smart people, and really good cryptographers. They have the leading zero-knowledge proof people developing, so we just copy their stuff. So we have the same exact trusted setup as Zcash does. They're going through and creating a more
complicated. If they colluded, then you would have problems too.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Yep. I mean, this
I'm
is
not saying it's
no. I mean, this is not. We're not perfect. We're experimental. We're taking Zcash technology and doing it a little different, going after a different market, and making it very usable. But oh yeah, there's possible problems. And so we pull their upstream stuff. So their algorithm is proof of work to prevent the SIP attack, and it uses Equihash. Equihash at the time was designed to be fairly memory intensive. Memory intensive is the ideal towards ASIC resistance, but people figured out how to first mine it on GPU, and now there's ASIC miners, both from InnoSilicon and from Bitmain for Zcash. So we just copied them on that. Now, I was at a discussion of where that Zuko and Dara was leading about what they're going to do about the ASIC miners. And basically their development process is they don't hard fork very often. I think it's three times a year. And so if they were going to change their proof of work, it would be able to be done in April of 2019 is when they can fit it into. And they don't know what they're going to do, but they're going to announce that by August 15th. So I don't know what they're going to do. If I were them, I would keep everything the same and just say there's going to be a bunch of ASICs.
Do you guys have scheduled hard forks?
Yeah, three times a year. So the sampling upgrade is at the 2-year anniversary of the launch, and they want to meet that. Sampling is huge. It's everything that they want to be in. It enables so many different things. And then I think it's three times a year. Because hard forks are difficult. And we go through this, and this is just...
It's a very good idea.
It's a mandatory.
It's so controversial, obviously, from the Bitcoin not being so afraid to do a hard fork.
Well, a hard fork, I mean, someone can attack it and split the chain, but if all the developers are going with one chain, then there's not a reason to. It's not like there's two versions all of a sudden. But whoever doesn't upgrade before the hard fork block happens, they're off on their own chain. So we're doing one next week, so we published the new code last week. Call and make sure every exchange upgrades. Ledger Wallet has to upgrade. All our people that take payments on it have to upgrade. Everybody has to upgrade, or else that part of the ecosystem won't work. And so we do, at Zcash, we do mandatory upgrades. We'll only do a hard fork once every 4 months, because it's just a real pain in the butt. There is a more efficient way of doing the proof of work. Sorry, this is such a long answer. You can change some grammar settings on Equihash. It'll make it so GPU unmineable. There's no Equihash ASIC miner for changing the parameters. Bitcoin Gold just forked to that last
wallet.
Every single integration we do, we have to call, we have to talk, we have to pay them, we have to have developers help do the integration. It's kind of an uphill battle. And it's sometimes not very rewarding because on our Discord, it's our internal or our community discussion, people are like, you gotta get on Binance.
When Binance.
And we had started talking to Binance. And our main developer guy, business developer guy, had great negotiated them down, got all sorts of stuff. Then we paid them, we got a timeline for doing it. And so this happened, and our timeline was like 4 months after we did the whole deal. And we have NDAs that we have to do with these people, and just all the standard business stuff. So people are hammering us on when we want to get people to pull the Zen Cash off the exchanges and put it to use. So people that have a need, well, first of all, for people staking it for their secure nodes and super nodes, that's one way to pull it off. Creating the ability for people to put it in a hardware wallet like Ledger, so then people pull it off exchanges. But then we actually have to create, just like your question was, a target audience of people who want to actually use it. Because if we get a million people to each have like one Zen in their wallet to use it, that's a million Zen. That's like 25% of our outstanding supply. What if they had like two or three Zen each? And that would, because of this demand, it would drive the price up. We don't care about price per se, although if the price goes up, the amount of US dollar equivalent funds that we have to pay developers and marketing goes up every month. So right now, we get about, I think it's 20,000 Zen a month in the foundation to pay people. That's about $400,000 a month equivalent that we use to pay marketing developers and things like that. When Zen was up at 60, it was like over $1 million we had a month to pay. So we can't hire our team too much. We have to be able to go up and down. So the demographic that we initially figured that we want to go after is people that value private transactions and private communications and make it easy for them to use the transactions and the communications.
Question, Charles Hoskins.
Yeah.
Okay. So did he do this out of the goodness of his heart, or was he using you as a use case for the treasury?
Yeah, so that's a great thing, because we helped Charles Hoskins fund, so the treasury development, we paid his guys to do that. So that's great, so that was helpful. But when we talked with him initially, he's like, okay, they all seem like normal people that are actually trying to do something and not just make a quick buck. So I think he might have bought some Z Classic before the fork.
So is there a strategic relationship between Cardano and Zencash?
Well, Cardano was developed by IOHK.
Right.
And Zencash has development contracts with IOHK.
Right.
So there is a relationship, but I don't know if you want to call it strategic or not.
Okay.
But they did try to develop a treasury for Ethereum Classic, and that got shot down. And they had been paid to do a study of the Dash treasury, and they found some issues with it. So this is their chance to implement and show a treasury model that works. So I think there's some value to Charles Hoskinson from that relationship.
So in hindsight, was the hack a good thing or a bad thing for Zencash?
Oh, man. At the time, it really, really sucked.
Yeah,
I bet. We're talking about the developer.
Insider attacks.
The nastiest.
Yeah, but I mean, it made us very cautious about making sure we have no single point of failure anywhere in our process for personnel or anything like that going forward. Sometimes a crisis gives you the opportunity to get closer to the people that you work with. So it did open up that opportunity for us to work more closely with IOHK. That lead developer wasn't actually a very good developer. He didn't like working with other people, so it was good that he publicly repeated us and left. Yeah?
Did you
already ask?
I want to fully circle around and answer that. Sometimes my answers
are I think Michael Tidwell had a question.
But
he gets to ask.
I'll get Michael next. But who would have the idea of needing private transactions? Everybody needs them, but there's some people need them more than others. So like people in Venezuela, maybe they need them more than others. People in North Korea, maybe, or Malaysia, or other places, or Vietnam, or maybe parts of America where people are worried about surveillance. I think we have a lot of freedom here, but other people have different opinions. But I think that now there is a technological barrier of entry to being able to use it. But I talked to some of the very libertarian type radio hosts. There's one out of Arizona. He's like, I want totally untrackable private communications. He's like, I get on Signal. It's supposed to be encrypted, but every time somebody new gets on Signal, it tells me. He's like, that's not what I want. I want totally untraceable communications. I'm like, well, we got that. So there's so many people out there that want it. We just have to let them know that it exists. Michael, you have a question?
Question. I have two questions. One is, so your origins come from Zcash, and you use the same mining algorithm as them. I was aware that y'all got attacked by, you know, 50, like hash rate attacked. What makes your project susceptible to that, but not Zcash, or are they both susceptible to the same attack? It's just you had a lower hash rate. And then maybe you can dig into that a little bit. And then the second question is, currently as it stands for the foundation, how do you? I know you said eventually everything's going to be transparent on every Zcash you spend, but how are decisions made on what should be purchased with the current 10% that y'all are bringing in? Like, what process do y'all have internally, or how do you make that decision?
Yeah.
So those are my two questions.
Okay. So 51% attack. All right. Let's talk about this for a little bit. So we use the same mining algorithm as Zcash, Equihash, and they have probably about 10 times as much hash power directed toward them. Now, people could take 10 times more. Take about 5% of that hash rate and redirect it towards Zcash, and they would have 50% of the Zcash hash rate. Now, what can you do when you have more than half the hash rate? Well, you can build your own chain. And so the consensus rule that we have, this is the Satoshi consensus rule, which is the longest blockchain that's published becomes the one that everybody switches over to. So we had an attack last month. Let me tell you how it happened. We have a blog post on this on our website, so it's none of this is secret information. You can back and review it. That's all in the block explorers. So somebody withdrew 3,000 Zen from an exchange. Then they set up to run their own private mining operation. Maybe they rented from NiceHash, maybe they didn't, and build their own blockchain that they didn't expose to the rest of the Zcash nodes out there. They deposited that 3,000 Zen in a different exchange, and then they created a block where they didn't deposit that 3,000 Zen. So everybody's chugging along on the main chain. They get 3,000 Zen at this exchange. Then they withdraw the 3,000 Zen into that exchange. And meanwhile, they're mining a separate blockchain where that 3,000 Zen deposit didn't exist. And then they expose that, and then all of a sudden, that 3,000 Zen deposit to the exchange never happened. So they got the 3,000 that they were supposed to have sent, and then they got the 3,000 they pulled out. Then they have 6,000 Zen. Then they did it again. They deposited 6,000 Zen, ran a parallel blockchain in private. It was longer. They exposed it after they withdrew their 6,000 Zen, and then they had 12,000 Zen. And they did it again. Now we were monitoring. We knew this was possible, and so we have people all over the world.
Then they lost everything.
We contacted the exchange, and we're like, "Hey, your transaction confirmations are at 6, which means basically after 6 transaction confirmations, after 15 minutes, they give credit to the person who does the deposit." We're like, "You got to crank those up." So they brought them up to 100 transaction confirmations, which I think is about a two-hour period. And at that point, the attacker Zen was stuck on the exchange. Some other strange things happened after that. But basically, that was the 51% attack. It was like a bank robbery. There was somebody that specifically did a specific set of actions that stole money from an exchange. So no Zen was created out of thin air. But
the exchange got all their Zen back, it sounds like.
They did.
But
because
the guy left it on, but, it was like a bank robbery.
Drop it back.
You dropped the back on the way up.
So they got lucky about that. I'll give you that.
Okay. So it wasn't really a successful double spin because they ended up losing all the Zen they stole.
Right.
They got greedy.
They got greedy.
Wow. I didn't know that.
But that's the type of attack that's possible. A double spend or a...
So what's the... So pretty much the precautions. I know y'all since moved to a proof of stake.
But it sucks. Nodes. It sucks because I had to test out this Pornhub integration, and I went to deposit Zen, and they're like, okay, you can have credit after 200 confirmations. I'm like, wait, 4 hours? I'm going to bed.
I'm not even going to watch.
Right? So nobody wants a deposit to take 2 to 4 hours. So we got to fix that. So actually, our developers came up with something and have run it by the IOHK engineers. And it is a change to the Satoshi consensus rule. So we're actively developing that right now. And basically, if someone mines a private blockchain and doesn't expose it to the rest, when it becomes exposed, the longer that private hidden chain is, there's going to apply penalties to each block. So we have to develop that, we have to implement it, then we have to run it on testnet for a little while, so we have to set up both the test suite and then the but that's what we're doing as a first step.
A network partition can, not saying that's likely, but a network partition can hurt in the future if that's the way.
It can.
So the second question about how you'll internally decide to spend funds, what's that process look like? Right
yeah,
now?
So, well, kind of like a small business at this point.
Okay.
We have budgets. We have different divisions that we allocate responsibility to. And they each have a monthly budget. And we talk about it internally amongst the directors and then spend it. I mean,
okay.
We want to get all the Zendas created into
nothing fancy right now. Okay.
No, we don't have any internal special voting mechanism. It's we got about 50 to 60 people overall that work for us directly, and we have I think 5 division heads.
Yeah, that's fine. I was just curious.
So I mean that's a time proven way of running a small business type thing. But we're also very community driven, so we try to make sure we're very transparent in what we're doing, the decisions we have a live stream, bi-weekly update. We just had one earlier today that lasts for about an hour. We tell everybody what we're doing. We take questions and answer at the end of it. And so I think we're one of the most open and transparent cryptocurrencies out there, at least about what we're doing.
Okay.
It'll get better as we continue to progress and do the treasury and voting and stuff like that. So I think that was, there you go. That was pretty much the presentation. Thank you.